So here we are. Yes, it was very hectic getting out of Raleigh. I am in Shelby, North Carolina. We're here for the Shelby Ham Fest. A pretty good way to start a Ham Radio Now tour. The big over the road is to start at a Ham Fest. We've been here to the Shelby Ham Fest before. We'll take a quick look around. I'm here in large part to do an interview with somebody, Roger, W4RWG. Roger's the president of the Southeast Repeater Association. So hopefully we'll be able to do that out in the flea market. It's not going to be part of this show. It's going to be part of something else that's coming up, talking about frequency coordination and, you know, maybe that radio programming I'd hoped to be able to do. But we'll take a look at the Shelby Ham Fest, and this will begin the on-the-road part of the adventure before I get to Austin and do the DCC. Let me show you what I've got here. Here's camera B, the point of view camera, and what it's looking at right now is the new camera. There's nobody standing behind it, no Jeff, no Cliff. This is the new camera, and I'll show you a little bit about it. It's also very small. It's not as quite as small as the point of view camera here, but it is pretty small and lightweight, going to be a lot easier to carry around. The thing that makes it particularly valuable to me is that it has all of this external audio capability, professional two-channel XLR audio input capability. And here are the wireless receivers sitting on top. They receive the signal from the wireless transmitter here on the wireless handheld microphone. So it's a whole cool system. I'll show you my frequencies. I have to find new frequencies every place I go. These sit in the middle of the television band on, quote, unoccupied channels. And back in the analog days, there was always an unoccupied channel, because back in the analog days of television, there couldn't be two adjacent channels in any one town. They had to be on separate frequencies. I'll step on my tripod. They had to be at least separated by one channel, and usually two, because they bled over and overlapped. The RF didn't bleed over, but receivers weren't capable of separating things. So any place you went with these wireless mics, you could find some empty space. This is frequency synthesized, and it's agile. It goes from 626 to about 662 megahertz. TV channel is 6 megahertz wide, so you get an idea of how much space you can cover. So you could always find an empty space. Well, now that we're digital, any one town can have 3-4 channels all side by side. They can be right up next to each other. I think that's more a matter of what the receivers are capable of being selective about than what the transmitters do. You know, none of them really bled outside their channel, even in the analog days. So in some big markets, you can't necessarily find an empty channel. It gets real hard. Here, we're well within the coverage of the Charlotte area television transmitters, but they're not occupying every channel. In most places I've been, there are empty channels. But when I move from one place to another, I could move into the spectrum that a local TV station is using. So I've got to move all the wirelesses off, and I had to move both of those to a new frequency. Okay, so that's the new camera. I'll still be using the old camera for interviews at home and stuff when I've got a chance to set things up, but I don't think you'll see me toting it around flea markets and ham fests and things like that, but it's here. Let's take a look inside the Q-mobile. We are heavily loaded, and my suitcase isn't even in here. It's back at the hotel. But lots of other stuff keeps the good old RAV4 heavily loaded. I don't know if I've done a good look at the antennas. Gordon did, to some extent, when we did our look at the Q-mobile outside of HRO in Charlotte. HRO in Atlanta. We took a quick look. I'll give you a little bit better look. This is the Tar Heel full-size, I think, Model 200 screwdriver antenna for HF. You know, I've got to clean that. I'm told you can just unscrew these little screws up here at the top, and this translucent shell will slide down and you can clean it. and then there's a big whip. When I first got this antenna, they didn't recommend using a quick disconnect. I have to use a disconnect because I go into a lot of garages and it would be difficult to unscrew, and you really don't want to be screwing and unscrewing a connection like that all that often. It's not really designed to be screwed and unscrewed that much. So the quick disconnect works, and now the Tar Heel folks, they'll sell you one. They don't tell you not to use one anymore. I guess whatever problems people were having with them weren't that bad. At least it was better to have people able to connect and disconnect pretty quickly. So that's the Tar Heel antenna. By the way, we're set for over-the-road mode. Again, that's Cindy calling me on the phone, but I will not be answering. We'll just let it ring for a little while. We're set for over-the-road mode, which means that all the antennas are in their tall condition. And I have to go in and out of my driveway back at home. So I have short antennas that that go on the car when I'm just driving around home. The garage at home and a couple of client garages, typical parking garages that only have a 7-foot clearance. But when I'm on the road, I put on the big antennas because they work better. Just about everything on the roof is in NMO mounts. In fact, everything on the roof is in NMO. Can't see my viewfinder. There we go. And they are all in holes. I don't do magnet mounts typically. The antennas up here in the front, I should have put a couple more in the middle of the car. I kind of wish I'd put some holes in. I didn't do these holes. I didn't do this installation. I had it done by a radio shop back in Cary. This is the scanner antenna back here. That one there is a Larson 2-meter 440 dual bander, and that one is connected to the 2820. Up here in front, this is sort of my utility antenna. Right now it's another Larson dual bander, and I will be connecting that to the Kenwood APRS, which I haven't had time to set up yet. The one in the middle is a Larson 220, 5/8 wave 220 antenna, and the one on the right is a Larson, I guess I like Larson, 27 megahertz, 28 megahertz, 27, it's on the CB radio. Up in front, can't put a through the hole mount up here because it's a double wall inside the hood, so it's got to be these Diamond K400. And what kind of antenna is it? Okay, that is a Diamond antenna. I guess we'll be doing a Diamond commercial. There's the model number. It is a tri-band antenna because this goes on the Yaesu 8900, so it's got to do 6 meters as well as 2 meters and 70 centimeters, and does a pretty good job. Let's see if I can get a better background. No trees in the background. You can get an idea what that looks like. It's a very tall antenna. And it's a bright, sunny day. It's going to be like 92 degrees today for the Ham Fest. And over here on this side, I have no idea what that antenna is. I think it may be a Comet. It may be a Diamond. It's an oldie but a goodie. And it's just a dual bander. No, I take it back. It's a tri-bander. It also does 6 meters. Yeah, it does, because I put this on the ICOM 7000, although I don't have the right duplexers in line to do 6 meters on the 7000 with this antenna, because the 7000, walk back to the big camera, the big little camera, the 7000 puts 6 meters out the HF antenna port. It's got two antenna connections. One does HF and 6 meters. The other does 2 meters and 70 centimeters. Well, you don't find very many HF antennas that go all the way up to 6 meters, but the tri-band antennas are not that hard to find. I kind of wish they'd put 6 meters over on the VHF, UHF port. Because it would be easier to run a single antenna. You can run a series of antenna splitters and combiners and get things over there. And I've put that together. It didn't seem to work very well, so I've got to try that again. So it's time to head on into the... I'll show you the radios in a future episode. or maybe later on in this one. It's time to go on into the Shelby Ham Fest and just take a quick look around, and then we'll wrap up this piece. And we'll see if I can actually get it into the editing system sometime before 2 or 3 weeks from now. So on into the Ham Fest. Tell you what, I'm going to stand here all day. It's in the shade. Well, the Ham Fest is in the Cleveland County Fairgrounds, your standard county fairgrounds, which means, of course, it's got the racetrack, and we'll be out in the barns and in the grass. This is the first building that we encounter just inside the gate. It's the one that we were in last year when we did some interviews. It's not air-conditioned, so it was very toasty. It's going to be very toasty in there today. I have mentioned in previous programs that the Shelby Ham Fest had fallen on somewhat hard times. It had been for decades here at the Cleveland County Fairgrounds. They had a dispute with one of the fairgrounds managers. I think somebody knew that had come in. I'm not really talking about the details, but it was all in the paper. It's in a previous show. They moved to an adjacent county, about 30 miles away, for 5 years. He had a 5-year contract. They honored it. When it was over, that guy was gone. The guy that was a butt here in Shelby in Cleveland County. And they welcomed them back, and so they came back. The Ham Fest last year, and even at the other fairgrounds, was something of a shell of its former self. They used to have all the major manufacturers, Kenwood, Icom, Yaesu, and back in the day, before my time, probably Drake and Hammerlin and Collins and all those folks. They're probably all here. Gone. Not here now. We'll see an Elecraft from the local guys, the Southeast guy from Flex. He'll probably be here. Kind of curious to see what else we're going to see in here, the hot building, and down there, the air-conditioned building where the high-dollar booths are. So let's take a look. Come on in, you guys. Come on in close. I found some fans. Who are you?
I'm Jeff, NC4J, from Fletcher, North Carolina.
And I'm Eric, W4ENC, from Mills River, North Carolina.
And how have you found the Ham Fest so far? Have you been to Shelby many times before?
I've been quite a few times. The little bit warm today, but we're making it.
I'm sweating. I'm starting to drip.
I see.
How do you compare it to previous years? Is it getting better again?
I think it's a little better than last year. We're yet to see if the tornado comes through about 5 o'clock like it did last year.
That's true. There was quite a storm that came through.
Came out of nowhere and blew down most of the tents in the boneyard. You remember that?
Yeah. Was it a tornado? Was it really?
No, but they thought it was. It blew down most of the tents in the boneyard.
Yeah, it did pretty good. Now, have you been coming for decades?
No, I've probably been about 10 times. Eric's been quite a few more times than that.
Okay, so you remember it from the glory days of the past?
Yeah, I started coming in 89. And yeah, I remember then it moved out to Dallas and came back. And last year it seemed like it was a little less. And now it looks like it's came back a little bit. So I think they're trending back where they were.
Okay, I hope so. So let's keep on looking. Thank you, guys.
All right, absolutely.
That's great. Something that's important to know is it looks 11:30 in the morning. So, it's one of those ham fests that probably peaks about, somewhere between 9 and 10. But it is looking pretty good from this little perspective. More foot traffic than I remember from last year. The space here behind me, back in the glory days, that would have been all full. That's a little slot that we were in last year. But now we'll keep working our way down the aisle and see how things are. Who am I talking to?
Thomas Rogers, KJ4OUP.
So you are a ham.
I am a ham, yes, sir.
And this is wireless communications. There's your sign back there, but you're pressing Moto Turbo here.
That's correct.
Moto now, if Turbo. I say Moto Turbo, a lot of people get mad at me and say, that's DMR, damn it!
That's correct. But, Moto Turbo is built on the DMR standard, except for once you get in a higher level, trunking systems, which is typically not seen in the amateur community. So the Moto Turbo radios today are fully compatible with the DMR standard, in essence with DMR marks and the North Carolina PRN Moto Turbo network.
Okay, so you're a commercial dealer.
I am a commercial dealer that's also a ham radio operator, and so is Robert over there. So we are, and there's a lot of amateur people in our business. I mean, because we have a passion for it, we do it on a day-to-day basis, and we do it as a hobby too, so it's pretty cool.
Were you early into the ham radio, into DMR?
Early?
I mean Moto Turbo.
Early, not really. I have to say that working in the commercially in the Moto Turbo has really brought me into the DMR marks, because it's one of those deals that I have a test radio for my customers, and for me to program it and use it on DMR marks, it to me was a no-brainer. So,
and that's an interesting point. To you at a commercial dealer, no big deal, but the average ham who buys one of these radios, they can't program it themselves, is that correct?
That's correct. You do need the Motorola CPS, the customer programming software, which is...
Can anybody buy that?
Anybody can buy that. It's $295 list price from Motorola, and anybody can purchase that.
So it's a lot more expensive than a ham is used to paying for programming.
That is correct.
And now, is there cables and stuff they got to buy too?
There's also cables they got to buy for certain models. It varies the cost. There are other model cables that the ham can build. So, I mean, and it's a very simple build.
So that stuff is kind of designed for a shop that's got a bunch of radios, not a ham who's got one.
I would say so, yes, but there are...
One ham could use it on one. It's just expensive.
The cables aren't that expensive. Some are $45, some are $75.
Well,
it depends
the
on the model. Plus the software, you're correct. But mainly what we've seen is a ham club will purchase the software and then program all the members' radio. So the cost is spread around. So it's not as expensive as it would be if one person purchased the software by themselves.
What do you guys charge to program a radio, just a one-time shot with a bunch of frequencies?
One-time shot charge, bunch of frequencies. I'll be honest, I'd have to get back to you on that. But
can you ballpark it? $50?
My boss would kill me if I were to ballpark it. Because it really varies, you know, because we do, the problem is we do simple radios like 16-channel radios, and we do 500-channel P25 radios. So that cost varies. For a turbo radio, couple channels, you know, for an amateur person, you're probably looking at $75, maybe $50.
Okay, so once again, Ham would have to think pretty hard about all the programming that goes on with it. You're right, if a club can put stuff together and make that semi-convenient, Motorola's never going to come out with a radio a ham can push buttons on, are they?
Probably not, but I don't want to speak for Motorola, but you're probably right.
Do you do other brands besides Motorola?
We do not. Well, I take that back. We do Vertex. We do Vertex as well, because Motorola purchased Vertex in 2013, I believe. So we do Vertex radios as well.
Were you ever part of the Google thing?
The Google thing.
Well, you're not Motorola. Google owned Motorola for a while, right?
Google owned Motorola Cellular Solutions. So Motorola essentially broke off in two. One became Motorola Solutions, which is your typical two-way radio, public safety, business radios. And the other one was the Motorola cell phone industry. Google bought that industry and then turned around and sold it to Lenovo at a loss. So... That's good.
I think they kept some patents.
Yeah, they kept some patents.
That's what they wanted.
That's correct.
All right. So do you have any like really quick capsule advice for a ham interested in getting into this Moto Turbo DMR thing in digital VHF?
It's technically digital UHF 440 band here in North Carolina. Quick tidbits.
Buy a radio, program it, get on.
Buy a radio, program it, get an ID from DMR Marks, and get on the system. And it's great. It's really cool, because you can talk statewide, crystal clear, digital audio. You know, it is a cool thing.
Okay, and the network seems to be growing?
The network is definitely growing. Scott came by this morning, told me my map was outdated, which I knew that when I printed it. They've brought on multiple repeaters. I think they brought on one yesterday in Dillsboro, South Carolina, and they're looking at putting one in Asheville, one in Waynesville, one in Greensboro. So the system is built. It's almost North Carolina statewide coverage.
I was looking at the online maps, which, by the way, they're accurate, so you could just print one of those out. And North Carolina seems to be real big in this DMR thing, bigger than many other states.
I would say so, but I think that's because it's a cart before the horse type deal. It's where the system's growing, so more people are attracted to it because it covers such a large footprint. Therefore, there's more incentive to build out that footprint. So it's kind of a snowball effect where everybody's flocking to it.
All right. So over here in the peanut gallery, come on up here, Jeff. is someone that we have seen on Ham Radio now before. I made you a big television star.
Oh, I know you did that. I thank you. I really appreciate that. That was wonderful. Great.
I tell you what, I am going to shut up now because I don't know if you've looked at the YouTube comments. Every other YouTube comment is, the host needs to shut up and let the guy talk. So here, have a mic.
All right, well, okay.
There's the camera.
That's right. Yeah, Gary and I, about a year and a half ago, I guess it was, we spent a good amount of time talking about DMR, and at that time it was still in its infancy in the United States and in North Carolina. But as we were just discussing here, DMR has started to, you know, build itself up as a really popular communications method among amateurs, especially in the digital market. As we were talking about, DMR, again, Moto Turbo is the brand name, DMR is the protocol, it was originally designed for the commercial market, but of course adapted to the amateur market through, you know, the various inexpensive radios and hardware required to put the whole network together. As we can see, as was discussed just a few minutes ago, it is growing in popularity. It is, a very viable means of communication, especially, throughout the United States and throughout the world. Now, we're getting a lot more diverse in, setting up different talk groups, setting up different channel paths, and such and so on and so forth. So you don't key up repeaters all over the country or all over the world. You know, you're getting a lot more localized, so that you can talk into separate areas or separate parts of states and so on and so forth. So, it's up and coming. There's a lot more to do. A lot of people jumping the bandwagon. I don't even remember how many IDs that were issued, but I know that in America, I think they're, well above the, 20,000 mark or someplace in that area. It's growing real fast. So hopefully we'll see a lot more coming.
He is never going to stop talking. I really should have shut up a long time ago. So you've probably seen this Kinect Systems, the CS7000 coming up. You interested, excited about that? I can't ask these guys. They don't care. They don't sell.
Well, I do own one. I would like to point that out. I do own one to demo it out, and it is a decent radio.
You have the 700, right?
The CS700, yes, sir.
Yeah. Now, the 7000 is the one that's really got my attention. You're in frame. The 7000's got my attention because it's going to do multiple modes.
Oh, really? I have not seen the 7000. I'm sorry. When you said 7000, I assumed 700.
So. Yeah, 7000 is not on the market yet. They're hoping for fall. But as a matter of fact, I've talked to the guy on Ham Radio now. So you got some research to do. Do D-Star, DMR, and he's hoping to put a few other things in there. Maybe that new Yaesu. Have you heard about that Yaesu thing?
I have not. Somebody was.
He's got a lot of research left to do.
And we hope that Yaesu will jump on the bandwagon. And when it came out with the FT1D, I guess there were some marketing decisions as to whether they would put DMR in it. Supposedly,
which they did not. That's what we were talking about. We were guessing
about that before. I mean, it is capable basically because it's using the AMBE2 encoder. But they obviously didn't write the software for it either. It had to do with the hardware, maybe memory specification or whatever. But there are a number of other companies that are coming out with DMR-capable radios other than the CS700. I know Hytera is looking at, I think they have one. And there's a couple of the, Asia brand markets that are coming out with other, radios that... Question is, will they work into the? They may work into the DMR system. Will they? All the features be able to be compatible with what DMR Mark has? That's still to be determined. But as I said, there's more options coming out, and I think you'll see a lot more happening in the future.
Is it busy with local people? Are they actually talking, or do they just have the radios?
Well, it's like all the other repeaters. You get a lot of people listening. Do you have a lot of people talking? Yeah, you have spurts at various times where you have a lot of people communicating back and forth. And of course, now again with more talk groups available, you have a lot better time to talk to somebody locally without having to key up, a lot of repeaters throughout the state.
Okay, and we haven't mentioned, we probably ought to, the thing that this DMR Moto Turbo hangs its hat on, it's the two channels on one repeater thing.
Right. That's right. The time domain or the two-slot TDMA types scenario where you get two channels for basically price of one.
Yeah, one repeater, one duplexer, one antenna, one radio, and but it's actually, how do I describe this? It's on the air, and then it's off the air, and then it's on the air, and then it's off the air. Well, you're still hanging on. You're mashing that push-to-talk button as hard as you can, but your transmitter's turning on and off, and somebody else's is turning on and off in those empty spaces. That's amazing. How does that work?
Oh, it's all through time sync and, through packet data type stuff. And, it all comes out in the end. It comes out of your radio, and you hear the audio, hear real good audio, by the way, coming out your radio.
People have said that there's a limit to how far you can get away from the repeater for it to be able to do that synchronization thing. Is that true?
Well, it's like anything else. It's in digital, it's either there or it's not. I mean, it's not like in the old days where you could go down the white noise and you could still be intelligible. Digital, once you start getting to a certain point, you get to a point where the packets can no longer be decoded. So therefore, it just basically goes silent. If it can't be decoded, it just kind of goes silent.
But what I'm hearing is that you could be well within range of the repeater, but I don't know, 30, 40, 50 miles on some of these wide coverage repeaters, but it's too far. I mean, there's too much transit delay or something, latency, that keeps it from hanging on to that two-channel thing. Does that really happen, or do people work DX on these repeaters?
Well, I mean, you can talk all over the world on the network.
No, not the internet.
Oh.
I've got to get it. All of these digital people, they're so wrapped up in the internet. RF. We're going back to RF.
Okay.
The time it takes my signal to get to the repeater and back is critical for this turn on, turn off, turn on, turn off. Is there a distance where that stops working?
Well, I mean, you look at how much power you're putting out, whether you're in a mobile or portable. If you're in a mobile, which runs more power, you can go more distance. If you're in a portable.
Okay, he doesn't understand
all
me.
Right. So the repeater serves as a timing leader for the various, the two time slots. So we'll call them time slot A, time slot B. So when the repeater keys up, or anyone keys up the repeater, the repeater is constantly transmitting. It's just, it differentiates which time slot it's receiving on.
Yeah, the repeater's the traffic cop.
Exactly. The repeater's controlling that synchronization. So, and that's why when the hang time of a repeater is very crucial in digital, because you want to ensure that it's constantly keeping that synchronization even though no one's transmitting at the time. So typically the hang time with a digital repeater is about 6 seconds, and that's really to keep that timing, the synchronization going.
Okay. Have you found that there's a distance limit where you get too far away and it doesn't do the switching properly?
I have not. Typically, when you get so far away, you're just dropping out. It's not a synchronization issue. It's just there's more packets lost than can be recovered, because there is a lot of forward error correction in the digital, because they're digital packets, and it can actually regenerate the voice audio from various broken packets. And it comes a point when you get so far out, it may not be able to regenerate that. But if you think about it, the repeater is always typically more power than the transmitting radio. So the synchronization is not your limiting factor. It's your talk in from your handheld or talk in from a low watt mobile, et cetera.
It's your BER, bit error rate is what he's referring to. A little bit ago about, once your BER gets so high, bit error rate gets so high, then you're no longer able to reconstruct those packets. So therefore, it just drops out.
Okay, thank you guys. YouTube trolls, screw you. I let them talk. So I think I mentioned how the Alacraft folks have volunteers that come to their booths, come set up booths at a lot of ham fests. And so they don't have to show up everywhere. They just have folks who do that. But I don't know if this is a volunteer booth or not. It's pretty fancy. Let me see if I can find out. Who am I speaking to?
Don Wilhelm, W3FPR.
Don, is this is a very fancy looking booth. Now, I understand that Alacraft does a lot of volunteer stuff. They do a few corporate booths at the Big Ham Fest. Which one is this?
This is a corporate booth. All the equipment is provided by Alacraft. David down here, my partner at the booth, is a full-time employee of Alacraft. I am a part-time employee. I do repair work on the K2, K1, and KX1 transceivers. And I'm here basically as a volunteer, although part of my expenses are being paid.
All right, so you muddied the waters.
I have muddied the waters. There are a couple of other folks. One gentleman was here earlier who is a volunteer at the booth, and there should be another one showing up this afternoon if promises hold true.
Ellicraft does a lot of total volunteer booths, their own equipment, their own people at lots of small ham fests.
Yes, they do. Coming from California, it just is not economical to come in for a one-day ham fest. Multiple-day ham fest, like here at Shelby, where we know we're going to get adequate traffic, we can bring in a corporate booth.
All right, so yay.
Yeah, yay. I enjoy being here.
Thank you very much. Appreciate it.
You're quite welcome. Have a good day.
And I'm sweating like a ham. So, turns out, I did enter that building at the real hotbed of activity. It petered out toward the end, and lots more T-shirts and stuff, which is fine, but not the jam-packed ham radio that it used to be in olden days. I'm going to head over for this building now. This is the air conditioning building, and we'll see what else is inside. Inside is cool. Air conditioning, and it works. It's mostly dealers and some clubs, and the ARL is over here. Yeah, Flex is over there, and no Kenwood, no Icom, no Yaesu. But we're doing okay. Again, it's afternoon now. What time is it? 12:30. So the crowd has probably thinned a lot from its maximum. A decent ham fest. Would love to see it back to its glory days. Enough of that air conditioning. Back there is the flea market. That's looking pretty good. The crowd is thinning out. It's now approaching 1 o'clock. So let's go see what's in the flea market. And I got to go find Roger for that interview. Hope he's still here. This building may be the best news I've seen about the resurgence of the Shelby Ham Fest. This building was dark last year. There was nobody in it. And once again, it's getting later in the day. This is not like Dayton, for sure, even like Orlando, where the Ham Fest is busy until closing time, 5 o'clock, 6 o'clock. Those are the few Ham Fests that stay that busy. There's some more space back here. Come on, settle down, picture. A very different color back there. It's all daylight and blue. This space, there were a few people in it last year, but it was not as busy as it is right now. Now, back in the glory days, there's the new camera. Back in the glory days, that territory was absolutely chock full. You couldn't squeeze anybody else in. This space was full. But going from almost nobody there to getting busy again, well, that's good. So, got my fingers crossed for you, Shelby. I needed one of these the other day, but not anymore. Okay, I think we're all on here. Who am I talking to?
Okay, you're talking to Rick Vassar from Newport, Tennessee, and my call sign is KA4TUE.
And you guys are part of the 3902 Ham Radio Gang.
That is correct. We talk every night from 7 p.m. till 10 p.m.
On
3.902, that's correct.
Would that be like plus or minus QRM?
It's probably...
You got enough kilowatts that you can keep the frequency?
Oh, sure. We got enough that we can keep the frequency, for sure.
So, see, that was going to be my question. Okay. People who've watched my show know perhaps where I may be going with this. What would you do if you ran into somebody from the 3903 ham radio gang?
Well, usually we just, if we hear somebody on 3903 and we're carrying on a QSO on 3902, usually we'll go down and ask them, to maybe move up the band or down the band. Just
kind of like this, get off my frequency. We've been here for 45 years. Like that?
No, sir. No, sir. We're more polite than that. We just ask them to move that the frequency on 3902 is occupied, And, of course, some people can't hear it, some people can, so we just ask them to move.
Same deal if it was the 3901 ham radio gang?
Well, if it's the there's not a 3901 amateur gang that I know of. There is some on 3900, which they we don't interfere with those, and there's some on 3905, and we don't interfere with those.
3900, that's 2 kilohertz below. That's a little tight.
Yeah, it's a little tight, and it's also in between 3898, which there's a group there that talks, but we deal with it pretty good.
Okay, see, the thing is, that you haven't seen my show. A lot of people have, but you haven't seen my show. I was talking about channelizing. Wouldn't it be cool to channelize so you got that channel and the next group is 3 kilohertz away?
Well, it would work much better for amateur radio if that was the case.
Oh, you don't realize how much email you're going to get from people who don't like that idea.
Well, that's the way it is when you carry on a QSO every night or on a frequency as 3902. We like to be an interesting group, and we like to work with the other groups, like on 3900. They don't seem to bother us as bad. Now, 3905, they're far enough away that they don't bother us either. So we like to get along.
What? That's three. Keep forgetting your frequency. 3905, that's 3 kilohertz. That's
yes,
plenty far away.
Yes, it is, sir.
So channelizing wouldn't bother you?
No, channelizing wouldn't bother us as long as there's no interference, you know.
Well, it's either they're going to be right on your frequency or they're going to be, if it's 3 kilohertz channels, everybody can do that.
Everybody can do that, and everything will be just fine. Everybody will get along.
What's your email address?
My email address is...
Okay, guys, get them. Thank you, Rick.
Thank you very much. Enjoy your day.
You too. Ooh, he doesn't know how much trouble he's in.
Oh, we're ready. Yeah.
Y'all can see the sign back there.
Can you?
You know what's going to happen here. I got a question, but first I got to know who I'm talking to.
My name's Hugh Brunson. I'm from Greensboro. Calls AE4N. I'm the world's most famous ham.
This of course,
baby
you are.
Brother.
Yeah, this is W4KLC. Name here is Mark.
W4KFC.
LKLC. Kicking.
ALC.
Yeah, KLC. Chicken. Kicking little chickens.
Kentucky. Never
kicking
mind.
Little chickens. You got it.
All right. So my question here is, you guys are the Rag Chew Bunch from 3915, 3927 megahertz.
Right.
What would you say if I showed up from the Rag Chew Bunch from 3916 or 3928 megahertz?
We'd say, welcome aboard and buckle your seatbelt.
Hey, welcome aboard. Have you had anything to eat? We've got chicken, we got fish, we got whatever you want to eat.
Deer
we got
kebabs,
food for you.
We had tenderloin. Yeah. Fish,
yeah.
You said fish.
You got a posse back there behind yeah. there that are going
Pain
to be watching
yeah.
out for you if I screw up too much.
No.
But I'm trying to get you in trouble here because those two groups I mentioned, they're 1 kilohertz away. Isn't that a little tight?
For them it is. We don't use the part of the spectrum they use. We use everything above S20.
Yeah.
They use anything, everything between them.
So 20. You're all amplifiers?
Yeah.
Except me. I'm appalled at people that will use an amplifier.
Beam antenna, yeah, so I don't really need
two elements on 75, four elements on 40.
Yeah. So,
at 100, no, he does.
At 150 feet, so.
Yeah, okay, so you own the channel?
No, I don't own anything. I just occupy the frequency.
You guys, actually, you do have a built-in solution to the problem. If you're on 3915, and suddenly someone comes up on 3916, you just go to 3927.
Yeah, we just that's what we do.
There.
We've been doing that for years.
Yeah.
3927 group organized at the end of the Vietnam War, which, as I recall, was 1975.
What the guys don't understand is they'll, you know, you get on the frequency and you get on there every day, day in, day out, then you go, this is our frequency. Well, it's not your frequency. It's everybody's frequency.
First come, first
so if you're there first and you got a conversation going on and you got some people, you just can't, we can't go in and say, hey, you're on 3915, you guys are going to have to leave. We got to move. So you need alternate frequency somewhere that everybody knows where you are and go meet on that frequency. So.
And we are probably the most accommodating group on
yeah.
amateur radio today.
Especially with food.
Yeah,
and
we try to be.
And we're intelligent also.
And very extremely, particularly me.
Yeah. yeah.
You agree with that?
Absolutely, 100%.
Yeah. I'm Billy Bob N3MIK. I'm his Elmo, and he's a genius, so you know I have to be.
You taught him everything you know?
I taught him everything he knows, but I didn't teach him everything I know.
And when he gets out of jail, he's going to apply.
Yeah. When he'll be out of jail, this is the end of August, about the middle of next month.
Yeah. Probably the 16th or 17th.
He'll be out of jail.
So let me try my plan on you guys. I was thinking it might be a good idea to channelize ham radio, 3 kilohertz steps, keep the interference down.
No, we had that.
They called it CB.
Yeah, you got cormers, you got these guys that don't have license, these guys that don't fit in anywhere.
Yeah,
what they'll do, they'll come up and get on the frequency, and when they get on the frequency, they corm and make noises and sounds and all this and never give their calls. And yeah, that's what you got now. So channelizing is not going to do any good.
No.
But it would keep people off of 3916 and 3914.
They're more than welcome to operate there.
Yeah, we're going to go back to crystal sets.
Yeah.
Well, you know, actually, it's not going to work anywhere but 60 meters. I want to do it on 60 meters where we're already channelized.
Yeah, probably work there, but on 35 meters, 40 meters, it won't work.
Are we being ganged up on back
here? Yeah. They want to get involved in.
Daddy, I got to go pee.
These are all tweeters.
Yeah.
They tweet. They're all all extra class ham operators, but they tweet a lot.
That's in for LMLs.
He'd go tweeting with you in a minute.
Yeah.
All right. So I think I found out what I wanted to know, and you guys are great sports, and thank you very much.
Yeah.
We appreciate you stopping by.
We appreciate the interview, and we'll send you the $25 as soon as possible.
Yeah.
They understand how this really being. I'm really being ganged up on here. I got a feeling I'm either in very popular or a lot of trouble.
No, you're good to go, Gary.
Yeah, it's time to go, Gary.
Don't worry.
7-3.
Thanks, you guys.
Good luck in the contest.
Thank you, buddy.
See, that's how to do it. Looks like the Shelby Hamfest is kind of wrapping up, at least for Saturday behind me. Don't expect Sunday to be too good, but I'm not going to be here. Saturday turned out to be better than I thought. A lot of people I talked to said it was a lot better than last year. Hasn't regained its former glory. Don't really expect it to. It maybe not ever. Most Hamfests have not regained the glory that they hit back around 2000, 2002. But it's better than it had been last year, and hopefully it's going to keep on going. Yeah, it is my camera that you walked in front of. That's okay. I just did a conversation with the guys here at the Southeastern VHF Society, and I expected it to be part of this program, a little 5-minute conversation. Turned out to be closer to an hour, so it's going to be a separate show, and I'll do that as soon as I can put that stuff together. And I never found Roger. I ended up talking here a lot. That is also a testament to the size of the flea market and the ham fest. My only instructions were to meet him in the boneyard. And I walked around a couple times and never ran into him. I was a little bit on the late side, so it could be he had come and gone. Could be he never made it. Could be he's sitting out there and I just didn't see him. Okay. So we're going to wrap up the Shelby day of our voyage to Austin, Texas. Tomorrow, getting on the road, I'll make it a little bit farther than Atlanta. I'm going to try to give myself some evening time, maybe get some editing done, maybe get this online. You never know. We'll find out. Got the equipment that I'm hauling around with me. And we'll do some on-the-road stuff as well. So for now, for this episode of Ham Radio Now, on the road to Austin, I'm Gary Pierski in 4AQ. Don't forget to visit Arvin. Arvin's back at the shack, back in Cary, North Carolina. But his home on the web is hamradionow.tv, same as our home on the web. Stop by there if you enjoy the programs and want to help us pay for doing all this stuff. Punch the button and send some money. 73, over and out.